the observance of communion. One of the last things he said is, I will not drink of this cup again until I drink of it with you in my kingdom, which is actually a reference to the Galilean marriage rituals. We've become engaged. We're really, you might as well say we're married. The Scottish have a thing where they call it hand fast, where two people, they don't have a minister to minister, marry them, so they have some vows and oaths, and typically there's witnesses, and they are in fact married until they didn't have a formal service, but they are married, might as well be. The Jews, they have their betrothal, they're considered married even though they live apart, as we live apart from Jesus Christ right now, because he is in his Father's house preparing a place for us. But remember, he said, I won't drink of this cup again until I drink of it with you in my kingdom. At the marriage supper of the Lamb, he fulfills that a promise, because now we are celebrating our wedding, the bride of Christ and Christ himself, the bride being the church, us. The church is not a building, it is those that belong to Christ. And he fulfills that promise. And other people have got this idea, some of the ideas are crazy, we're all floating around clouds, playing harps. I'm quite certain where that one came from, but it's cute. Some people picture, well, we're just going to be in wonderful grassy fields, sunshine, and breeze blowing, birds singing, the child playing with the serpent, not being harmed, the lion landing. And all of these things are factual, true statements. But the biggest thing, the most wonderful thing, is that we're going to be worshiping Jesus. We're going to be praising God. And yet, you read the passage, this goes on forever and ever and ever. And at some point in the mind of a child, and it happens with adults too, because I've actually heard adults say, that one sounds kind of boring. All we're going to do for the rest of eternity is sing praise to God, but we get bored. Well, for those that are there that belong to Christ and have perfect understanding of where they came from, what he did to get him there, what they would have been without him, it starts to make you want to sing some praise and worship. But here's the next beautiful thing about it. We see him singing praise, we give worship to God here, we've seen it before here. We're told that it's going to be day and night forever and ever and ever. They don't get tired and they don't get bored because they are in the presence of God. They are seeing. The scripture says we will be like him, for we will see him as he is. But imagine this. The scripture tells us that the Lord inhabits our praise. The scripture tells us that where two or three of us are gathered together in his name, there is he in the midst of us. The scripture gives us representation time and time again of where God is being praised and worshiped. He fills the place with his glory, just like the tabernacle of the Old Testament, where he filled it with his glory so much that it was like a shining cloud inhabiting the tabernacle. When you give praise and worship to God, he is pleased. He finds it to be, the scripture says, a sweet aroma. But more beautiful than that, the more we are focused on God, the more we are just giving up ourselves in praise and worship to him, the more of himself he can give to us. He can reveal to us. So, what we're able to see from these people worshiping and praising praising God in the book of Revelation is really applicable to us in our lives now. They don't get tired of doing it. They don't get tired physically. They don't get bored, because with each time they are giving their praise and worship to God, He is refreshing them by revealing more of His glory and more of His wonder and more of who He is to them, which only makes them more praise and worship Him more. And that principle will hold true for us here in our lives. When I run into challenges and calamities, I have found that, like, well, my challenges and calamities, my situation gets worse. My thinking gets stinkier. I become more focused on that, which gets me in a worse frame of mind, which brings me down more, which makes that problem seem worse. It's a vicious cycle. But the times when I keep the presence of mind and redirect my focus to Christ, and people say, you know, you spout out the song all the time. I get the kids laugh at me at the house when I break out and song, go through the house singing songs. People have caught me at work, man, you must be really enjoying your job. You're in here singing and Jesus songs and stuff, and it's like, no, actually, work stinks right now. I'd rather be someplace else, but I'm singing Jesus songs because, hey, I'm not focused on those problems anymore. And it boosts my attitude. It boosts those good chemicals that your body produces. It redirects my focus on Jesus. And then the problem won't seem so bad anymore. So big and terrible. And I feel refreshed. And oftentimes I find myself then able to return to meditating on God or studying His Word or talking to Him. And oftentimes that's when I get some of the coolest revelations of God. I find something I haven't seen before in Scripture. The Lord's now got me in a position where He can show it to me. Hey, you know, I've read the Scripture 100 times, but I've been missing this. And it's like, wow, man, you know, cool. Have you read it? So I can't say enough about the example that we're getting. I mean, do you think John just recorded these songs of praise and the fact that people worship people continually just to give us a picture of what heaven is like or what heaven is going on? Remember, this book is the revelation of Jesus Christ, not the revelation of what the Antichrist is doing, not the revelation of how I'm going to punish the devil. Don't worry, those kingdoms are already mine. As we read back up here in verse 15, it's a done deal. You know, I can reveal it to you as a means of encouragement, or I can just let you see how I do it when I do it. But this is so that you can see more of me, so you can know more of who I am. And here, John, write down all these times you see people praising me and worshiping me, not that I can have a big ego, you know, and I got people praising me and worshiping me all the time. You know? No, it's so that we know how to improve our relationship with Christ now. You know, we didn't have to have all these examples to change the fact that that's what we're going to be doing in heaven, and that's what we're going to, that's so we can be doing it now, and knowing how wonderful it is for us now. Any thoughts or questions on that?
Your battery's about to die.
Ma'am?
Your battery's about to die.
Should be. Okay, we'll fix that when we have to fix it.